Dear students, what we consider next is restricted least squares. Restricted least squares. That is, how to test linear equality restrictions. We will consider a t-test procedure and also an f-test procedure. T-test procedure is not generally recommended. What we consider for our future reference is the f-test procedure. It is convenient to introduce restricted least squares by using an example. We consider the famous Cobb-Douglas production function, yi is equal to beta 1, x 2i raised to beta 2, x 3i raised to beta 3, e raised to ui. Y is output, x 2 is labor, x 3 is capital. Now, convert this into log form. Ln yi sum ln beta 1 plus beta 2 ln x 2 y plus beta 3 ln x 3 y plus u y. So, ln yi sum of beta 0 plus beta 2 ln x 2 y plus beta 3 ln x 3 y plus u y. Beta 0 is ln beta. Now suppose that this production function exhibits constant returns to scale. That is, beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1. We know that if beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1, this production function exhibits constant returns to scale. If it is greater than 1, increasing returns to scale. Less than 1, diminishing returns to scale, as we have explained already. Now this is an example of a linear equality restriction. If beta 2 is plus beta 3 is greater than 1 or less than 1, it is a linear inequality restriction that we cannot handle using the method and procedures discussed. So we assume that our beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1 production function. We want to test it. The question is how to test the linear equality restriction that beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1. Now, there are two approaches. One is the t-test procedure. The other one is the f-test procedure. The t-test procedure is simple. We know that under the assumptions of the classical linear regression model, t is equal to beta 2 hat plus beta 3 hat minus beta 2 plus beta 3 divided by standard error of beta 2 hat plus beta 3 hat. Beta 2 hat plus beta 3 hat is equal to beta 2 hat plus beta 3 hat minus 1, because we assume that beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1, divided by root of, this is plus, so root of variance beta 2 hat plus variance beta 3 hat plus 2 covariance, beta 2 hat, beta 3 hat. This quantity follows T with the degrees of freedom, with the 3 degrees of freedom. Sorry, with the n minus 3 degrees of freedom. Because this is a 3 variable model. Now, estimate beta 2 hat, beta 3 hat, the variances, covariance, formulate the T. If the T obtained from the sample exceeds critical T values for a chosen level of significance and given degrees of freedom, reject H0, that there is constant returns to scale. Otherwise, accept it. If T is less than T alpha, then that is absolute value of T is less than T alpha by 2, accept beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1. There is constant returns to scale. This is one procedure. But remember this, this procedure is not generally followed. The reason is that t-test procedure is a kind of, what to say, post-mortem examination of examination to find out whether the linear equality restriction is satisfied or not. We estimate the model. After estimating the model, we formulate the hypothesis and test it. It's a kind of post-mortem examination to try to find out whether the linear equality restriction is satisfied or not. A more direct and efficient procedure is incorporate this linear equality restriction directly into the estimation procedure. That will give us more efficient estimators. That is what we do. The F-test procedure is used to test linear equality restrictions like this. This procedure is more efficient in the sense that the restrictions are directly incorporated into the estimation procedure itself. We will not, it is not based on an unrestricted model as in the case of the t-test. So let us see how this linear equality restriction is incorporated into the estimation procedure and how we derive the F statistics to test the hypothesis that beta 2 is plus beta 3 is equal to 1. That is whether the production function is, whether the production function is subject to constant returns to scale. Since beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1, we can write beta 2 as equal to 1 minus beta 3, or beta 3 as equal to 1 minus beta 2. We can write the linear equality restriction like this. So we use this form. Now our model is ln yi summum beta 0 plus beta 2 ln x2y plus beta 3 ln x3i plus ey in log form. Now this can be written as equal to beta 0 plus 1 minus beta 3 ln x2y plus beta 3 ln x3i plus ui is equal to beta 0 plus ln x2i minus beta 3 ln x2i plus beta 3 ln x3i plus ui. We take this term to the left. ln yi minus ln x2y can be written as ln yi by x2y is equal to beta 0 plus beta 3 ln x2y x3i by x2y plus ui. ln yi x2y is equal to beta 0 plus beta 3 ln x3i by x2y plus ui. Now you know that this is k by l is written as a function of y by l. Output per hertz is a function of k by l. Actually, this is the famous per worker production function which we study in microeconomics, where output per head is, or output labor ratio is a function of capital labor ratio. Now, we have the original model converted into log terms. Then, we have incorporated this linear equality restriction. Actually, if you suspect that the production function exhibits constant returns to scale, this kind of information is known as non-sample information. So if you have information beyond your sample, then if you can incorporate this non-sample information also in the estimation procedure, it will give you more efficient estimates. Another example we will consider later. So this is an example of a non-sample information. And the question is, how do you get such non-sample information from previous empirical work? If you conduct a production function, we will review the literature, and from the previous literature we have in a similar study, there was constant returns to scale. So we can use this non-sample information in our estimation procedure, and it will give us more efficient estimates. But remember this, if the non-sample information is not correct, it will be highly misleading. That is another thing. Anyway, so we transform the original model using this non-sample information as ln yi x2y sum is equal to beta 0 plus beta 3 ln x3i by x2y plus ui. That is, the production function is converted into per worker terms. The original production function is converted into per worker terms. So this procedure, that is this the procedure by which the procedure by which the original model is converted into a different model by imposing the restrictions is known as linear equality restrictions. Now the question is, how do we know that this linear equality restriction actually holds? For that, we formulate the F. F is equal to RSS restricted minus RSS unrestricted divided by M whole divided by RSS unrestricted by N minus K is equal to sigma u hat square R minus sigma u hat square u r by m whole divided by RSS restricted, sigma u hat square unrestricted by n minus k, where RSS R is RSS from the restricted model, that is sigma u hat I square from the restricted model minus RSS by from the unrestricted model. Sigma u hat square from m is the number of linear equality restrictions. In our example, as we have introduced only one, we have m equal to 1. It depends on the number of restrictions imposed on the original model. And this quantity follows f with the m and n minus k degrees of freedom. With the m and n minus k degrees of freedom. So, to test whether the equality, linear equality restrictions holds or not, we formulate this f, and if this f exceeds f alpha for the chosen level of significance and given degrees of freedom, we reject H0 that beta 2 plus beta 3 is equal to 1. Otherwise, we do not reject H0. Now, the question is, what is the logic of this F test? We know that RSS restricted is always higher than RSS unrestricted. If the restrictions are valid, if the restrictions are not valid, RSS R will be much higher than RSS U R relative to this quantity. But if the restrictions are valid, the difference between these two will not be much. So if the restrictions are valid, this RSS R will be much higher than RSS U R relative to this. So F will be a large value. A large F is evidence against H0. And a small f is evidence in favor of H0. So if the restrictions are not valid, f will be high. If restrictions are valid, f will be small. This is the procedure. And just as we have derived f in terms of this R square, we can also write f as equal to R square from unrestricted minus R square from restricted by m divided by 1 minus R square unrestricted by n minus k. In terms of R square, this is the f. But remember this. This R square from unrestricted is larger than R square from R, because unrestricted means all the variables are there. So R square will be very high. If restrictions are valid, R square, this R square will be much lower than this. If not valid, there will not be much difference between these two R square values. Not much difference between these two R square values. But there is one more point. We cannot compare this model with this model using this form of f, because R square from this model is not comparable with the R square from this model. As we have suggested earlier, to compare two models using R square, dependent variable will be the same. N will be the same. But here the dependent variable here is ln yi. Here it is ln yi by x2y. So that we cannot use R square form of f in this model as the dependent variable is different. We can use this form if and only if the dependent variable is same. That should be kept in mind. So this is the procedure for, this procedure is known as restricted least squares. The procedure is the F-test procedure, and in the F-test procedure, we impose the restrictions directly into the estimation procedure itself. Directly into the estimation procedure itself. Now, given this, let us generalize the F-testing procedure. let us generalize the F testing procedure. F test has been used for a variety of hypothesis tests. So let us have a general F testing procedure like this. We have a large model, yi sama beta 1 plus beta 2 x 2 y plus beta 3 x 3 y plus etc. beta k x k I plus u y. X plus u y. Suppose that we have to test a hypothesis, say beta 2 is equal to beta 3. Or we have to test a hypothesis, beta 2 plus beta 3 plus beta 4 is equal to 5. For testing the overall significance, beta 2 is equal to beta 3 is equal to etc., beta k is equal to 0. Using the F-test, we can test a variety of hypotheses. The procedure is, we have a large model having all the variables. We have a small model incorporating the restrictions. We have a small model incorporating the restrictions. And this is the restricted model. Fit both the models. Obtain RSS from the restricted model, RSS from the unrestricted model, or R square from the restricted model, R square from the unrestricted model. Then formulate F. When you formulate F, always remember that in the numerator we have M degrees of freedom. M is number of restrictions. And in the denominator we have always n minus k degrees of freedom. In the denominator we have n minus k degrees of freedom. In the numerator we have m degrees of freedom. Let us see how this m degrees of freedom comes about. We know that suppose that we have a k variable model with the k parameters. Suppose that we introduce the restriction that beta 3 is equal to beta 4 is equal to beta k is equal to 0. Suppose that beta k is 10. Beta k is 10. So we have to estimate beta k is say 9. So we have a total of 9 plus 1, 10. Parameters in the original model. In the new model, we have 1, 2. We have to estimate only 2 parameters. 2 parameters. The difference is 8. Now, the difference is 8. In the true model, we have to estimate 9 parameters. Once the restrictions are imposed, we have only 2 parameters to be estimated, means the difference is 8. 8 means we have imposed the number of restrictions as equal to 3, 2, 2, 3, 4. We have imposed a total of, in the original model, we have we have 9 plus 1 parameters, that is 10 parameters. In the restricted model, we have to estimate only 2 parameters. The difference is 8. So 8 is the number of restrictions imposed. Because we are now ignoring all the 7 variables. So we have so to calculate the degrees of freedom in the numerator, it is degrees of freedom associated with the unrestricted model minus degrees of freedom associated with the restricted model. Degrees of freedom associated with the unrestricted model is degrees of freedom associated with the, suppose that n is 50. Degrees of freedom associated with the unrestricted model is 40 minus, so degrees of freedom associated with the restricted minus unrestricted. Degrees of freedom associated with the unrestricted model is 40. Degrees of freedom associated with the restricted model is, as n is equal to 50, n is equal to 50, and as we estimate only two parameters, it is 48. So it is equal to 8. 48 minus 40. Degrees of freedom of unrestricted 40. So that is the number of restrictions imposed, because we have 9 parameters and we impose 8 restrictions. So degrees of freedom of restricted minus degrees of freedom of unrestricted. So the general F testing procedure is like this. We have a large model. We have restrictions like this. We can impose any of these restrictions, and we have a restricted model. Then RSS from restricted and unrestricted, not the number of restrictions, that will be the numerator degree of freedom. In the denominator, we have n minus k degrees of freedom. When we test the overall significance, we have shown that degrees of freedom in the numerator is k minus 1. In the denominator, it is n minus k. K minus 1, because all the slope coefficients are assumed to be 0. All the slope coefficients are assumed to be 0. K minus 1. In this testing of the overall significance, beta 2 is equal to beta 3 is equal to 0. So we have k minus 1 degrees of freedom, because in the restricted model we estimate only beta 1. In the denominator we have n minus k degrees of freedom. And this is the general F-test procedure. And statistical softwares will compute all this very easily. You have to give only the command. And let me conclude. Remember this. T-test and F-test procedures are different. T-test is used for testing the significance of individual coefficients only. F-test is used for testing the significance of individual coefficients, but a group of coefficients. Now consider this model. We can obtain many situations. It is possible that when we use t-test, all these slope coefficients may be equal to 0. Such a possibility is there. All the individual slope coefficients are equal to 0. But when we test the overall significance, that is H0 is accepted. When we test the overall significance using F, H0 will be rejected. That is, taken together, there is a significant relationship between all the explanatory variables and Y. That means we are not able to obtain the individual effects, but we have a joint effect. And this happens because of multicollinearity, we will see later. The second point is, suppose that in a three-variable model, we have beta 2 and beta 3. In the joint test of significance using F, H0 rejected. But when we test individual hypotheses, beta 2, H0 may be accepted, beta 3 rejected. No problem. You will get such a result also. That is, H0 rejected when we test the joint significance. It is possible that when we test individual significance, one is accepted, the other one is rejected. Such a possibility is also there. That is not a problem. But suppose that all the individual coefficients are significant. F is also significant. Joint or overall significance. Such a possibility is also there. So remember this. When we test the individual coefficients, some of the coefficients may not be significant using t-test. But when we test all these together, we will have the overall significance. Overall significance. Then these type of results are expected. Also remember, to test the significance of individual coefficients, we use t-test. To test the significance of a group of variables, we use f-test. And always remember this, we have a large model, a small model, RSS from the large and a small model. In the denominator, we have n minus k degrees of freedom. In the numerator, degrees of freedom is equal to number of restrictions, m. Keep in mind always. When we test the individual significance, it is possible that null hypothesis may be accepted. When we test the significance of many variables together, H0 may be rejected. Such possibilities are also there, and such cases will be discussed in detail when we discuss what is known as multicollinearity.